Hey everybody, it is Thursday, so that means it's Throwback Thursday with me here on Facebook. Today we're going to be premiering part one of a short film called Time Spent by David Sylvian, my ex-husband, and myself. It is 1998, and David is about to release Dead Bees on a Cake. We are living in Sonoma, and his record label wants him to do an EPK for the release, so we convince them to give us the money, and we immediately spend half of it on an 8mm camera and start documenting our life in Sonoma. Isabel's a baby, Amir and Tanandre are really young children, and of course they're all grown up now, so this was 20 years ago. I feel really fortunate to have this short film documenting our life in California, such a sweet snapshot of our young family. And as many of you know, David has re-released Dead Bees on a Cake recently, and there were two versions. There was the white vinyl version and the black vinyl version. And on the black vinyl version, there's a portrait of David that I took. And we are doing a limited edition print of it. There will be 50 of them signed and numbered by David and myself. They are palladium prints, hand-printed by a local artist in Brattleboro, Vermont. His name is William Dixon. All the proceeds go to Isabel's study abroad program, so if you would like to support her, check it out. Buy one of the prints and enjoy part one of Time Spent, and I will find you guys here next week for part two, and you can go to my website, ingridchavez.com, to find more information about the prints, and I'll see you next week. Bye-bye. It is easy to become fed up with daily routine. You do the same thing day after day until finally you don't know what the purpose of human life is. Human life just based on daily routine seems like a huge trap. We don't want to look at this, so we don't pay attention to daily routine. We get up in the morning and have breakfast, but we don't pay attention to breakfast. Quickly and carelessly, we drink our coffee and go to work. But if you don't pay attention, you will eat breakfast recklessly, you will go to work recklessly, you will drive recklessly, and you will go to sleep recklessly. Finally, you will be fed up with your daily routine. This is human suffering, and it fills everyday life. The important point is that we can neither escape everyday life nor ignore it. We have to live by means of realizing the original nature of the self right in the middle of daily routine, without destroying daily routine and without attaching to it. Dainin Katagiri.
Inevitably, the first question has to be, why has it been 11 years since you last released a solo album? 5 years since you released material of any kind, and 3 years since you started recording this latest project. And quite honestly, there are no simple answers.
Sunlight falls, my wings open wide, there's a beauty here I cannot deny. And bottles that tumble and crash on the stairs are just so many people I knew never cared.
It's fair to say that after recording three solo albums, I wanted to pursue collaborative work as a means of stretching myself as a writer. It would also be equally true to say that I was in such a distressed state of mind at the time that it would have been difficult to focus or motivate myself to create more work of my own. But having said that, I didn't personally instigate much of the collaborative work either. The only project I actively willed into life was what became known as the Raintree Crow Project, along with Plight and Premonition, produced with Holger Czukay. It's the one I stand by.
I hold you in a sea of silence on the borderline.
I feel I benefited from these collaborative workouts in one way or another, regardless of the final success or otherwise of the projects. Working on the soundtrack to the video Still Cathedrals, I opened up my writing by incorporating improvisational methods of composition. This was developed further when working with Holger in Cologne on the Plight sessions. Holger has a wonderful knack of recording you when you least expect it, of creating a good environment in which to work. The experience pushed me further into pursuing a line of questioning which led directly to the Raintree Crow project. I'd originally conceived the band as one with a fluctuating lineup that would evolve from project to project. Once I'd decided on working with the ex-members of the band Japan, that aspect of the plan had to be reviewed. But as a model, it's still an idea I'd like to pursue, should the time feel right.
Recording angels and the poets of the night. Bring back the trophies of the battles that we've fought. Searchlights fill the open skies and I surrender.
The title of the album makes reference to the abiding themes running throughout. The material is wholly autobiographical, the key elements being love, devotion, and divine intoxication. Of course, the picture wouldn't be complete without the shadow side of all that being represented in some way also. Dead Bees on a Cake was for me a humorous, earthy, if somewhat oblique way of referring to the notion of the many deaths experienced on the road, a spiritual awakening, the ultimate being the death of the ego, merging with the object of desire.
While I slept, you stood in the colorful night market with pyramids of bright fruit piled high, where those who loved you, rushing back to their intimate stalls, held out pears that had been dreamed for you. And would the dream pear not come gladly once it knew this was you wanting to take it in? The dream pear chose reality, wanting your mouth as I did. Honestly, it was happy to be bitten. Brenda Hillman.
Waist deep in water, she starts to sing. The voice is familiar and draws me in. She's lighting the fires, I doused by hand, erasing the figure drawn in sand.
Under what could be described as tremendously fortuitous or benevolent circumstances. Not that we fully realized this at the time. We were both emerging from pretty intense, rather chaotic periods in our lives when our paths crossed. Initially, we were more like sparring partners than friends, but within 2 weeks of meeting, we were inseparable. Within 2 months, we were married. I'd been searching for a place to relocate to outside of London and the UK. I hadn't seriously considered moving to the States, but the decision to put down roots here seemed compellingly obvious once Ingrid and I had married. I saw the move to Minneapolis as something of a retreat. Consciously breaking ties, cultural and otherwise, afforded me greater isolation from what I perceived to be a virtual onslaught of stimuli. There was an intensity to my life in London that had become intolerable, unworkable. For years I'd found myself living in a state of perpetual anxiety. My relationship with Ingrid, our life together in Minneapolis, and all that was to unfold there, resolved the situation for me. In September 93, our first daughter, Amira Dea, was born. She immediately became the central focus of our lives for the next 4 years, along with our son, Tenandre, then 8 years old, and our own spiritual searching and development. The long Minnesotan winters allowed for a fair amount of isolation, promoting a close-knit family life, and a relaxed focus on writing.